Well, you know, I'm on Better Call Saul, which is nominated for Best Drama, and also we've got Bob Odenkirk and Michael McKean who are up for nominations as well. And this is our second time around for being nominated by the critics, and you know, it's of course we love people watching it because that's what keeps you on the air. But it's also it's such icing to have your peers and the critics go ahead and like the show as well. So we've been very fortunate with the first two seasons of Better Call Saul. We're in the middle of shooting season three right now. And I guess what I keep saying, it sounds so hackneyed, but it's true. If you liked one and two, you're going to love three when it comes out later on this spring.
Yeah, so tell me about being here tonight.
I'm so excited. Yeah. It's pretty thrilling. I'm representing the show. Tig Notaro, you know, I'm representing One Mississippi. And Tig Notaro's in Denver doing stand-up, and I play her stepfather.
Oh, wow.
I don't know if you've seen the show. It's great. And I play a very, you know, repressed guy who is described as having an emotional thermostat between room temperature and sleet.
Man, boy. It's going to be 30 raw, so it's going to be short, but very much impassioned.
Thank you very much. Have a great night.
Thank you. Any juncture. Having been written in 1982, winning the Pulitzer Prize.
So you're in the movie Fences?
Yes, I am.
You're also on Grimm.
Yes, yeah. We're coming into our sixth and final season of Grimm, and so it's bittersweet.
Guys, you are kicking ass right now.
Thank you for saying that very much.
Why?
Well, you know, it's funny because people say, oh, well, Trump won, you're going to get four more years of great comedy. I'd rather have four more years of a stable nation, and we can find the comedy elsewhere. You can always get another writer. You can always add another joke, but...
Do you feel like right now it's taking... I hate to say this, but it seems like it takes more courage now to say the things that you're saying than it would have in the past. I don't know if that's true.
Yeah, I mean, I think we certainly feel more passionate. I think there's a real fire in our bellies right now to feel like there's a reason to get out there and talk about things and shine a light on things that haven't been discussed. And if we can make a few jokes along the way, it's so cathartic. I mean, I have to say, the day after the election, being able to come into the office, it was quite the process for all of us, but coming into the office with like-minded people, and we're all just trying to support one another and uplift one another, and to have a job where you can actually potentially have some sort of impact is really nice.
Yeah, I think ultimately we discovered this year that there are droves of people who felt empowered to say and do horrible things because there were other people saying and doing horrible things. And I think the same thing goes if you're saying positive things. So courage isn't exactly as courageous when there's more people with you and joining you in the fight. So the more we talk, the more people will start talking as well. And, you know, maybe we can put a little pushback on the situation over the next 4 years. So.
Mr. Boyd, They say, oh, come on back. And then I go back.
Holiday plans. What are your holiday plans?
Opening gifts.
Turban. Why are you wearing the turban?
Midgiving. 10 more feet. 10 more feet.
Emma.
Come on, little girl. 10 more feet. Come over here.
You're the best. Yay.
Jeff, can you wave?
Yeah.
Jeff,
you rule.
Can you just give us a wave?
There he goes. Please come over here.
What are you wearing?
That was the only
it was good. I was sitting there, and you know, you sit there, and then all of a sudden, a camera shows up and points at you, and then you go, oh, I'm in the running. And then you hear the names, and it's completely a surprise.
Oh, I was saying your shoe is.
Hold it up, Kevin. Hold it up. Oh gosh, I'm just trying to figure out what's the last thing that happened to the characters and just really put myself in their situation and try to see if what comes to me.
And then how did it feel to win for Best Feedback?
Feels great. Feels really great.
Award means your collaboration with him and the like incredibly dynamic roles you've been able to play.
Well, this is the third time I've been honored with this from you guys. It's and all of them have been with my collaborations with Ryan Murphy. So it's not lost on me that he's provided me with more than one opportunity to play a complicated. One time I played a woman with two heads, and then I got to play Marcia Clark and. He's just very interested in the stories of women, human stories, really. Sometimes I think he thinks of them more that way. I don't know, I've been incredibly lucky to not be pigeonholed also with playing one particular kind of thing. I've gotten to do a really varied group of characters, so.
Sarah, congratulations on the award. Kira from Pyramid Team.
Yeah.
I want to ask you about, I understand you had a very interesting first meeting with Marcia Clark. Can you tell us about what she said to you and sort of what advice she
gave? I met Marcia Clark towards the end of filming this. We did 10 episodes. I met her when we were shooting probably episode 7. I had finished the Marsha episode and Ryan gave me his blessing. He said, if you still want to do it, and I was one of the actors, not everybody felt this way, but I personally really, really wanted to meet her, and I was discouraged from doing that in the beginning. They really wanted everybody to get a hold on their characters without any outside influence, and he gave me the go-ahead, and I emailed her that day, and we had dinner the following evening, and it was just one of the greatest, I've been starstruck many times in my life, but this was beyond being starstruck because of someone's acting talent. Like if I see Meryl Streep, I'm liable to, I don't know, pee my pants or something. But Marcia Clark, I admired her so much as a person, and I had read so much about her, and I just squealed like a little piglet when I saw her. And I saw her mole first, so I'm not gonna lie. I did see it, a little sun dappled. She was coming through a revolving door. And I could actually tell by the way she was walking, because I had studied her walk so much. She had been a dancer and she walked kind of with her feet out. And so I saw that first. And it was a pretty epic evening. And we've had many since then. Lots to celebrate, yeah.
Award and what it felt like being up there in front of the whole world, particularly for this role.
What we did when we shot it. We knew we had done something special, but it never works out like this. I think we all, when we left, we had our wrap party, had a wonderful time. We just said, well, you know, we did something really wonderful. Everybody lived through this project, so who knows what's going to happen. So we know we did a great job. We had fun. We made lifelong friends. So I let it go. So when the numbers came in about how many people were watching it, and that it had become an event, and that people, when we actually were, we'd go on interviews, they didn't want to interview us, they wanted to talk about the project. We knew that something had happened. We had touched someone. And that's, all of these things, these awards and things are icing on the cake. What we did together, and the fact that people, we did it in such a way that people were able to tune in this day and age of binge watching, that we actually created something that people would wait for another week to watch.
What was it like to step into the role of Churchill? Was it intimidating?
Yeah, it was very exciting, very intimidating, all at the same time, but bit by bit the excitement took over and I started to feel the wind in my sails. I found out about the role, the offer in January. I didn't start rehearsing until mid-June or shooting until July, so that was a lot of time.
And John, I'll just chill out here.
Oh, that's fine.
Having the opportunity to create roles and sort of be a creative force behind more inclusion in entertainment, and where, and what places do you want to go to next with the show and with any other roles in the future?
First, thank you. And I guess it feels good. I just want to, you know, I feel really good about being able to make things and also like getting, I don't ever want to be a show just like about diversity. Like I think that's kind of whack. Like I want to make shows that I would want to see and like have a flavor and a point of view that is true. So I think it's cool that to get recognized. I'm really thankful to the critics for recognizing the show. And I'm just happy that I do get to do that and make more roles for everybody. It's great.
Black men are thinking their lives, and I want to know what it feels like to be a part of a union, particularly in a country that's not necessarily celebrating those unions, to have somebody that you love and inspires, supports, encourages you, etc. So two different questions.
Just what it feels like right now. It's a little overwhelming, you know, but I mean that in the most positive sense, you know. I think I'm so close to it that I probably need some time away from the moment to really, to take it all in and to really understand what it means for myself, for my career, for my family.
Brian,
right
here.
Hey,
Brian, you
love
me.
Yeah.
All right,
guys, I'm
going
to
go. Congratulations. And Mr. Reynolds, standing right here.
What's coming next for Deadpool?
That's all in development right now. And that's where the sentence sort of ends. it's all coming together. We'll be up and running in the new year, so we're excited about it. Really excited about it, actually. Yeah.
Nothing more you can give us?
I can't really give much more away than, you know, other than what you know. I mean, Cable's gonna be in it, and we're sort of working that out right now and seeing who's gonna be the best guy for that, so it's exciting. Yeah. Sorry, I totally disappointed you. I apologize.
Here I am.
Yes.
Here from Pyramid TV, from one BC boy to another.
Hey, how are you? It's good. Snow this week here.
We did, you know, quite a bit.
Let's talk about the weather.
Yes. I want to ask you, of course, your story. You came down from Vancouver. your first night at a hotel, probably not too far from here.
Yeah.
Where you'll horribly get your beach stolen.
Yeah.
Tell me, like, what kept you going? I mean, a lot of people would have turned and gone, oh, what?
Oh, I thought that was kind of awesome. My first day in LA, my car was stolen. I mean, it was a great welcome to the town. I thought it was, you know, it fortified my nerve for what I was in for. It was, that kept, you know, what really kept me going was my expectations were extraordinarily minimal. My expectations were to try to get the Groundlings, which is an improv comedy group, and the sad thing is I ran out of money, so I ended up getting an agent and then getting on the sitcom eventually, and that was, you know, sort of reverse engineering in a weird way, but it was it really worked out well for myself. So I was very, very lucky, I'll say. Yeah.
Sarah?
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.
My biggest critic?
Yes, but like a constructive critic.
I know a horrible fucker named Ryan Reynolds that is awful. Just an awful human being to Ryan Reynolds. I mean that. Like, I grew up in a sort of vortex of self-loathing, frothy hate of myself. And that's actually what's great, because it's actually what informed and helps me in my career. But there's no critics have nothing on me. I can mince and dice myself just fine on my own.
Tell me about working with him. Kind of things you learned from him. Were you a fan of his
book? Oh, absolutely, absolutely. I was in complete shock when I had to do any scenes with him, and I just tried to watch him like a hawk, and it was like watching Da Vinci paint. You know, it really reminded me why I love what I do. I've worked with some of the greatest actors of our time, and he's the top for me. He was just breathtaking. I literally wept after every scene. I couldn't help it, you know. So yeah, it was a privilege.
You've gotten through Word to the Pregnant before. Is it different this time? How are you feeling?
It is funny to be back in the season pregnant, but it's always nice because it, you know, it gives some balance, I feel like, to it's a joy to be recognized for your work, and then also gives you the, like, oh, there's something really meaningful and family and grounded at the same time, so it's a nice balance.
You're known as being very fat and fashion savvy. You will look wonderful. Somebody who's so fashion savvy, you're playing a woman who was known for her great fashion as well. Tell me about how the costuming helped inform your portrayal of Jackie Cameron.
Yes, the costumes were a great help to get to be part of the role, and Madeline, who won tonight for her costumes, did such an incredible job recreating, of course, the very well-known dresses and suits that she wore during the assassination and even the days following that tell a story in themselves. So it was one of those rare instances where you put on the clothes and it's like a character in the scene, because it's so, like the pink suit, we know what's going to happen, so it has this sort of sense of foreboding, you know, when you just see it.
Changed your idea of what you thought of Jackie O, considering the fact that she is such a huge icon. What did you learn about her, or what changed your way of thinking about her?
Well, I think when I first read Noah Oppenheim's script, it was so surprising to me that she took authorship of her own story and that she crafted that whole Camelot myth herself, that it immediately gave me a completely different point of view of her, because I had only sort of considered her in a superficial way before as the fashion, the hair, the sort of what we know of her, this sort of style icon, and then to see this much deeper, more insightful, and incredibly intelligent person who really created a narrative that lasted until now was really impressive.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. A year ago, we were in AC, you said that you can't play people that are not written. My question is, with your win tonight, does this change your idea of what kind of roles will be available moving forward because of what kind of roles are available for you?
Tonight didn't change that for me. It has, it changed for me over the course of a few years since I've experienced this success. It's been a slow evolution of realizing that I've got to be the change that I want to see. Whether I would have won this award or not, that if there are roles out there and narratives out there that literally are great for people of color, then I have to run my leg of the race and make sure that that happens. And I felt the slow evolution of my success has really made that a stark reality for me, not awards, although I'm very appreciative of it.
Congratulations to all of you.
Thank you. We good, guys?
Great.
One question down here at the end.